and welcome to Mum In It, the podcast where we chat all things parenthood. I'm Harriet Shearsmith and I am indeed mumming it with my three kids, but I want to find out how other parents are navigating their parenthood and what that looks like. This season, we're talking parenting through a pandemic. And don't forget, at the end of every episode, I ask my guests for their parenting hack. Smallest things that will make the biggest difference. And if you're a fan of hacks and life tips, don't forget to check out my book, Mum In It, which is available to order now. Hi guys, I have Kaytee here with me, who most of you will probably know as the Nurse Mum on Instagram, and I've been really excited to chat to you because I've followed you and I've followed Jaxon's journey forever, really, ever since you first started, and I've loved your honesty. I think that's the one thing that really comes across on your platform, and the way you're so open, and I think it's really helped people and inspired people who are in the same situation to stand up for themselves and to demand better for themselves and their children. So if you would like to just introduce yourself so that anybody who isn't familiar with you and your platform will know who you are, go for it.
My name's Kaytee. I used to blog and it's kind of just turned all into Instagram, really, as the Nurse Mum. It's interesting to hear you say those things. It's really nice, actually. When I started sharing, which was via a blog mainly, the aim was, because I was in hospital, I'd just given birth to this beautiful little boy. I hadn't had the easiest of pregnancies, but I didn't expect any problems. There were sort of some flags in pregnancy, you know, oh, this isn't quite, you know, you've got a bit too much fluid, or like I was having regular scans and things like that. But I just didn't really, it never happens to you. Like that was kind of how I saw it, like, oh yeah, it'll be fine. Like it's just precautionary. And then when he was born, he passed all of the newborn checks, actually. There was no concerns at birth, despite having surgeons on hand and things like that. There was no concerns. He passed everything. And then the next day he developed jaundice, and we stayed in for a couple of days for that. Then we got out, went home, and he had like a lump in his groin. So we went into hospital and they said, oh, it's a hernia. We'll just book a surgery in a few weeks' time. It's not urgent. Kept him overnight for observation, got back out fine again. Nothing was being picked up. And then when he was about 6 days old, I was at my mum's. It sounds so weird to say you were in a place now that we're all locked down. I'll go there now. But yeah, I was at my mum's meeting lots of my friends because I was living in Leicester at the time for uni, and I'd given birth in Leicester because of uni as well. And so I came to Nottingham to see everybody, and just something wasn't right that day. I can't even describe it. I have to just say a mother's instinct is everything. It's all I can describe it as, because the things that weren't adding up to me were so minute or were such things that you wouldn't generally worry about. But for me, it just felt something wasn't right. And when I took him to the hospital that night, he went floppy on the way. I was having to hold his head up in the car seat. I called Leicester, where he'd been in the hospital for jaundice, because they'd taken bloods that night that we'd stayed overnight recently. So I wanted the results of those. So I called, and when I got through to one, I said, you know, I'm taking him to A&E. Something's not right. What's going on? And he was like, oh, you're on your way to A&E. Good. Having looked at the blood results, this is days later. So that was the first kind of sign that something wasn't right. And then when we got to the hospital, they just did test after test after test. And they were so good in A&E. They were absolutely amazing, because although things again weren't quite right, it could all be put down to the jaundice he'd had, because he's only 6 days old. He'd had like 3 or 4 days of jaundice. Certain things could be sort of brushed over if they had wanted to, essentially. And doctor came in and sat with me and says, what is going on? I said, something's not right. I don't know what it is. I remember just wanting to cry and feeling so frustrated, because I'm a qualified, well, I wasn't at the time, but I am now a qualified nurse. I'd done 3 years of training at that point. I didn't know. My training didn't go as far as I needed it to go. And they didn't know either. But my concerns led them to do more tests, and every single test they did, kidney, heart, brain, urine samples, everything came up with problems, came up with something not right, and came up with diagnoses. And so those first few months, well, we spent pretty much the first year in hospital. We'd get out for like a weekend, think we were discharged for good after 6 weeks or so, and bounce back in on the Monday and be in for another 4 weeks and so on. But it's around, I think he was about 3 months old when I started blogging, and all I wanted to do was, the main thing was actually people asking questions, what's going on, you know, even just close family, mom, your dad, my partner, his dad at the time was in London and friends, everyone asking. And I couldn't keep repeating these things that I could barely digest myself, that I didn't understand myself. So I started writing it out on a platform that would be sort of, you can all read it here. It's still personal because I'd be very open and honest, but I can't keep repeating this. Like, here you go. You can all open it. You can all read it. You can all discuss together. But that's that. So it was a method of communication, essentially.
Yeah.
And then the other thing was that I was in hospital, and I think a lot of children that are born with medical needs end up being either born prematurely. I always get asked, was he premature? But even by the doctor that we see to this day, was he premature? And he wasn't. And so we didn't have that sort of, he's not passed his checks, he needs to go to the neonates, or he needs to go to an ICU. There was no specialist area that he went to that were familiar with that. We went in when he was 60 days old and ended up on the assessment unit, which is where children go in with bronchitis, you know, all sorts of things in general, and more of like an in and out thing. And we ended up on that ward for about 6 weeks, which is a short stay unit. He's supposed to be there for a matter of days. So there wasn't the nurses that were familiar with long-term complex. I mean, there may be, because obviously people with disabilities will go in and out of there, I'm sure, or pass through there at some point, but no one stayed there for as long as we did. And there were no other parents in that situation. They would come and go. Like I say, there would be like windows between us, and I would see someone come in, stay for a couple of days, go, come in, stay for a couple of days, go. And we were there for weeks and weeks and weeks. I think up until about 3 months, we would still stay on that when we went back in and stuff. So I just felt really alone. And I remember saying to the nurses, the anyone pretty much, like, is there any counselling in here? Is there anyone that I could talk to? And the nurses would always offer up themselves, no, we haven't got those services, but I'll come and sit down with you. And obviously that wasn't quite what I needed. I felt like I needed proper structured therapy and it wasn't available. And so I kind of wanted to raise awareness of that and things like that. But then also I would say, you know, are there any other parents that I can talk to? Is there anyone going through my situation? Because I was still getting the updates from like Emma's Diary and, you know, all the apps that you join and all the emails that you sign up to when you're pregnant and you're excited, and they're telling you the milestones. And, you know, he was getting to 6 weeks or 3 months and he wasn't doing the things that these apps were telling me. And whenever I'd go on those community apps and the forums and stuff, there was nobody in my position. I remember searching one of the sites for child illness or babies that are sick, and what came up was things like colic and, you know, the things that come and go with a newborn, not things that are permanent. I remember one of them searching down the blog list of parents, and there were pages and pages. I remember clicking 3, 4, 5 pages, and there wasn't a single blogger on that page at that time that was talking about having a child or a baby that was sick and unwell with medical diagnoses. And it broke me. Like, I literally just felt so isolated and alone. And that's when I sort of opened my blog up to be public, thinking, if one other person reads this and feels like they're not alone, or even finds me so that I don't feel alone, it'll be something. It'll build something, it creates something. And that's where it all started. So hearing you say sort of those things about people seeing it and feeling comforted or feeling inspired, for lack of a better word, to speak up for themselves and things like that, it's pretty much where it all started and why it all started. I don't know if I've answered your question now.
You have. It really is a comfort. Motherhood in itself, I found to be isolating. And like you say, there's thousands, millions even, of things out there saying, oh, I'm going through this too. And to suddenly find yourself in a position that you didn't expect, that you hadn't been warned about, that could not have been predicted, and suddenly find that you can't find anyone who is going through what you're going through, I can't imagine how isolating that must have been. And I think the fact that you have put yourself out there and done it so honestly has meant the world to so many people, and has put people in a position where they don't have to feel what you felt. So I think people really resonate with that, and it's one of the reasons that people follow you, like I follow you so avidly, because you are totally bluntly honest about it, and you've got a great community as well. I think perhaps we can relate a bit more nowadays to the feeling of isolation now that we've all had these lockdowns, obviously not in the same way, but through not being able to see people, and the main source of communication we've had with people has been online. So there's proof there how powerful that online communication can be, and that online community for all of us. And I don't know how throughout the pandemic it has affected your care, Jaxon's care. How's it worked for you?
It's interesting what you say, because when the pandemic started, there was a lot of discussion within the community of parents with children with disabilities about how our life wasn't going to change so much because in some senses it was already so isolating. Examples being like when I was in hospital and said, is there anyone in this position, not being able to find anybody, but also like winter. So Jaxon, when he would get a bug or an infection, it wouldn't just be, even a common cold, it wouldn't just be that he was in bed for a day and needed some Calpol. It would mess up all of his medications. It would increase his vomiting because he vomits every day regardless, but that would increase, which also messed with his medications because then he'd be bringing up his medications that are vital for his organs to keep working. And so a common cold would put him in hospital. The number of times we've been in intensive care and the high dependency unit because I've had to take him into A&E, his vomit's increased, something's not right, and they've done swabs and it is just a common cold. And so when it came to sort of especially winters, we barely went anywhere as it was because I was protecting him. And a lot of parents will also feel the same in my position of protecting their children from the already existing common colds and bugs. You know, I would take him into hospital with the rain cover over him because when you go to an assessment unit or A&E, everyone's there sick with bugs and infections and everything. And he couldn't afford to get that, but he also needed to be there. And so in some ways, the isolation hasn't changed so much. It's the same with possibly children that are older with disabilities, where getting out of the house is a lot. It takes a lot. It takes a lot of planning. It takes a lot of physical ability to actually get out of the house. And then obviously there is the exclusion from certain places that aren't accessible by wheelchair. Even for example, nursery. I tried to get Jaxon into nursery from when he was about a year old so that I could go back to work. Or actually at the time, it was so that I could complete my final 3-month placement to get my nursing degree. And I had to go back because if I didn't go back then, I would have to redo the whole final year. And I'd done the whole final year. I just needed that 3 months. And so obviously I needed childcare. And he got rejected from 3 nurseries, all with very mysterious reasons why. The first one said their insurance wouldn't cover his heart condition. The second one took our calls. All of them I had visits with, and you know, everything was smooth sailing, and then all of a sudden I'm ready to go back to work and I'm planning things to go there, and then they call and say, oh, we can't take him. The second one said they were full, but my friend's child got a place the week after. And then the third one, actually they still owe me a deposit from about 2 years ago. We got as far as like we'd gone round, I'd paid the deposit, we'd agreed the days, and then someone did a risk assessment. Bearing in mind at this point we had a community nurse, I had an early years specialist, so a number of professionals on Jaxon's side involved that were all saying we're willing to come to the nursery and risk assess and see what can be done and see what adaptations may be needed, or to say if it's absolutely fine. The nursery did their own in-house risk assessment without any of Jaxon's documentation or any of his professionals involved, and said that they just couldn't have him. Yeah, so
wow.
There's so many things that are already excluding people with medical needs or people with disabilities from society in general. The pandemic has obviously still had a huge impact on everybody. I want to say it's gone from it's a choice to actually the choice being taken away, but obviously some people already experienced that anyway. I know some people have lost carers during the pandemic because obviously for a number of different reasons. I'm aware that the government, I don't know how to word this properly because I've not looked at it in about 6 months, but basically they eased all of the requirements of local councils in the areas of disability during the pandemic. So essentially councils had the option of whether they provided care or didn't when before they had to. And obviously some councils were fine and good and good morals and all of that, met people's basic human rights and needs, and some didn't. But then also I know parents that then said no to carers because obviously the carers is another person you've got to trust isn't breaking the rules, or some people are meant most are with agencies, so the agency will still send the care into different households, and some are mixed with children and adults, and a lot of adults are obviously COVID positive in the community. So not having the carers obviously takes its own toll because then they're having to provide care 24/7, which differs for different people. But yeah, I've seen a lot of crisis and I've seen a lot calling in despair. And I think it's hard because it's hard to see, because generally when the population kick up about something, some kind of change happens. You know, when it started and people were like, you can't, you know, furlough came into place, universal credits got increased, certain things were put into place to say, we hear you, you know, there's that much up for it. I feel like it's that whole, there's strength in numbers.
Yeah.
So if everybody's kicking off about something, they have no choice but to feel the pressure and make a change. But when the disabled community is kicking off about something, it isn't necessarily heard.
Yeah.
Because they're not there is a lot of, I mean, if you look at the stats, you would think that there was enough people to make an uproar, but I think mixed with exhaustion, not having the carers, being too tired to fight, not being in work, you know, people put people down. And, you know, if it's someone that's a top earner saying something, you know, or they're going to leave, all these things come into play that make them have an influence. Whereas I feel like unpaid carers are often bottom of the pile.
Yeah, it makes sense. And it's not right. Do you feel like people have become more sympathetic and a bit more understanding of actually what it feels like to be excluded and not to be able to go to things? Or do you feel like it's, again, just been overlooked? It's not had the impact that it needs to have to really make a change, to really say, actually, this is discrimination. People can't live like this. People can't be put in the position where they're not given the appropriate carers. I know you had a lot of problems with carers, didn't you, in various stages?
Yeah, I mean, it's not related to the pandemic at the moment. And thankfully, we just have the one and she does all of the hours. So she's only here, which means we've been able to keep a hold of her. But in relation to the beginning of the pandemic, the first time sort of people were saying, hey, you know, you lot being put into isolation, this is kind of what other people have been facing for a long time now. And there was some kind of like, whoa, oh, like a bit of shock, a bit of sudden understanding. But it's been a year now. And I think people now are understandably more concerned about their own life right now, because, you know, people are losing their jobs. People are feeling the mental health consequences of being isolated for so long. People are feeling their own exhaustion. And so at the moment, people are just trying to look after themselves, which I can understand. And I think what I would hope is that once this is over at some point, Dutch words, we can look back and then, you know, once people are out of the woods, yeah, and remember, and then maybe compare, and then maybe shout a bit louder. But at the moment, I think everyone's got a tough job on their hands just getting by themselves, yeah, which is understandable to an extent.
I think we are naturally apathetic as a species at times, and you know, people don't look beyond what's at their own front door, I guess. And I've been guilty of it. I think most people have been guilty of not looking beyond what's actually happening within your own life and saying, hang on a minute, that's not right, let's stand up against that.
It's another job for everyone to do, isn't it? You know, I didn't know about this world before I came into it, and I was definitely oblivious. I had no idea. So unless someone tells you, you don't know. But then there is sort of a sense of we should be finding out for ourselves. You know, there should be some level of common sense that says there's other people struggling. But again, it's hard because, you know, if your own front door's on fire, you've got to put your own fire out, you know?
Absolutely. Like you say, hopefully when we've moved past this, which I'm hoping with the vaccine, things will start to move forwards, keeping my fingers crossed. When we've moved past all this, hopefully people can support each other and remember what it feels like to be isolated and to be denied and to be discriminated against, even though they weren't really being discriminated against, but remember that they're people who are. How has it affected Jaxon? Has it affected him in any way, or is he completely oblivious to the changes that have happened because it hasn't really changed for him so much?
I think he is slightly oblivious because although he's 3, cognitively he's more around 18 month to 2-year-old, so he's not yet got that complete understanding of the world around him, and he's very much in the moment. You know, if you're entertaining me now, I'm not worried. Yeah. The last lockdown, there was a lot of him because he started special needs school in September last year, so that's like after the first lockdown. So before then, he'd only just been attending a nursery for a couple of months, and it wasn't set in stone, and there was a lot of hospital admissions, so he hadn't really got into a specific routine outside of our home anyway. And then he started special school, and he absolutely loves it and thrives there and is excited to go every single day. So then I think when this last lockdown came, it did confuse me a bit more, maybe over Christmas, even just the Christmas holidays. So before we even went into another lockdown, he was that confused of like every day he would wake up and be like, boss, school, and name his teacher and name his friend and be like, you know, and I'd be like, not today. And in the end, he just started saying back to me, he'd say all the names and then go, not today. I'm like, no, no, baby. And then obviously that went on and on and on for a good few weeks. So he definitely understood to some extent, and he definitely missed it. And health-wise, you know, a lot of things got cancelled or put off. Things changed in terms of like our hospital appointments became Zoom appointments. And some of it was really nice in some ways because, you know, we traveled to London and back for a few visit appointments, and even to the local hospital is a 40-minute round trip. And so in some ways it was nicer to just be able to go in the living room and do the consultation over the laptop. But in other respects, certain things haven't been done. And I'm only just seeing now in letters that say, you know, due to COVID, this hasn't been completed or this isn't yet happening. And that frustrates me because I think the things that are being blamed COVID aren't COVID related.
Yeah.
Certain things like referrals, a letter. How is a letter being sent blamed on COVID? You know, so there's bits and pieces and different aspects of things, but on the whole it's not been awful for him, which is good. And we've been in and out of hospital many a time during the lockdown. You know, I think we spent about a month in hospital during the first lockdown, and then we went to London hospital and spent time there and stuff. So in some sick ways we've got out and about.
in a fashion, it's not a nice trip to Dubai or anything like that, but you've managed get somewhere. I mean, how did you find it within the actual hospital setting? Did you notice that much had changed for wards that he was perhaps on, or the areas that he had to go into compared to how they were beforehand?
This kind of pulls back to me being a single parent, because I know there's been a lot of uproar and cries for help in regards to a lot of places are one parent only. But that's nothing new to me. That's how it's been the majority of the time. So that didn't really change for me, you know, telling me, oh, you can only have one parent with him. I'm like, okay, yeah, that's me. But I guess actually hearing other people upset about that kind of actually got to me in a strange way, because I wouldn't have heard about these things before, because, you know, if it's a two-parent family, they would go and they would spend the time with their child, and they wouldn't, you know, then all of a sudden they're only allowed one person, and there's outroar about it and there's outrage. And I'm just, oh, is that really, really bad? Like, I've been doing it on my own the whole time. You know, it was the whole, you need somebody there for you, for the mental support, for the physical support. Obviously, two-parent families, if it's one person, then the other person will drop them off or bring them food and do these things. And I didn't have that either. So it was heart-wrenching to see other people's perspectives of that, because I think sometimes you're so used to your normal, even just like with some of Jaxon's conditions, you know, sometimes I'll talk about them, play blasé, and people go, oh my goodness, like, that's not on. You should be, you know, yeah, shout loud about it. And you don't realize until somebody else says something is really difficult that you go, oh, that is really difficult. So in that respect, in terms of in the actual hospitals, I think other than the one parent rule, not so much. I mean, there's the masks and the gowning up more so, but I mean, that happens during procedures and things anyway. I don't think there's been a huge difference in the environment. I mean, toys for the first lockdown, you couldn't have any of the toys. A lot of things have been stripped, and obviously if you rush into A&E, you've not grabbed a box of toys on your way, and then you're in for 3 weeks and there's nothing for them to play with. You know, there's a level of guilt there, and obviously the entertainment side of things for them. But yeah, I think they were the main things.
Yeah, it's interesting what you say about it, how it casts a light for you on what you go through as just your daily normal, when other people are saying, actually, I'm finding this really hard. And you're like, well, it is hard, and that's normal for me. And it perhaps shouldn't be just normal for you. There are things that go on that you think, right, okay, that's actually not on. I think it's interesting that you say cast the light on it and makes you step back and think, because you do, as a mum all the time, you just get on with it, don't you? That's just motherhood. Some things you will look at and be like, God, I can't be doing with this, but you just get on with it. And then you have that tenfold as well, because you have the additional element of being a mum to a disabled child. And I think that is interesting that that has cast a light for you. Do you think that that has encouraged you to say, I need a bit more help here, or I need a bit more help there? Has it maybe made you feel like you can ask for that a bit more?
Sometimes, yes, and sometimes, I mean, with like the one parent thing, you know, there's nothing I can do about that. I can't be like, click, where's my husband?
Nothing happened.
This is not on that. I do not have a husband. So, you know, and yes, but then with more of his medical things, I think sadly there's quite a bit of, some would term it as gaslighting within healthcare, in terms of downplaying things. Or if you think about it in terms of maybe a nurse on a particular ward see something all the time, and so they're completely immune to it. Or a doctor, they see children with X, Y, and Z all of the time, so they see that all day, every day, 9 to 5, or obviously outside those hours too, and that's their normal. So then when you go in and you say this isn't on, they're like, well, it just is what it is. Yeah. You know? Yeah, that's it. And then you go to a group of people that have never experienced anything like it, and they're going, whoa, no, something should be done about that. Like, yeah, that's not okay, you know, it looks sore, he's in pain, blah, 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 and list the reasons. And then you sort of get that validation that maybe you shouldn't need, but that sometimes you do, because, you know, you're a parent discussing with a professional, and in some ways there is a hierarchy. And I mean, I tend to see it as quite equal. You know, I think my role as mum is equally as important as their role as doctor, which some may disagree with, but I see him all day, every symptom, every side effect, every consequence, every medication interaction, everything. And they then use that information to use their qualification, their education, to deal with it. So, you know, you can't have one without the other in a lot of ways. So yes, if someone does say, you know, that looks really bad, it does make me go, hold on a minute, let me call them back, because no, I'm not happy with that, you know. And it does just realign me with my own thoughts, because often I can go to a meeting and be like, look, I'm really unhappy with this, this is not okay, and they can go, it's a side effect, it's this, it's, you know, it is just what it is. I say, he's been vomiting every day since he was born for 3 years now, I've had enough. Oh well, he's got reflux, you know. And you hear it so many times, and you say it so many times, and it just comes back so many times, that you start to just feel like you're losing your mind in some ways, because you just think, is it really not that big a deal? Like, am I just supposed to get on with this?
And too much of it, kind of thing. When,
yeah, and then someone says no, yeah, and just someone saying no, like, you're completely justified in feeling like that's wrong, it definitely makes me go back and question more and harder, and, you know, if it needs to be a complaint. And it's strange in a way, but I guess some people get that from their partner. And I think in some ways I do use Instagram as a support system, which is where a lot of the honesty and rawness comes from, because, you know, something bad happens and I don't necessarily have someone on the couch with me that night to bounce ideas off or to vent to, or to say, you know, do you really think this is okay? There's nobody there. So I turn to a community that I've built for myself, and they get back to me, and, you know, they provide that. And I think something really quite special. I honestly don't know what I'd have done without it. So yeah, in that way, that's how they kind of support me.
That's brilliant. You know, I think there's something really awesome about a woman being able to say, this is my community that I built for myself, and I can offer them support in the same way that they can offer me support, and actually being able to take from that and being able to use it as a sounding board, being able to speak to other parents who have gone through similar, or maybe parents like myself who haven't gone through anything like that at all, who can learn and support and offer a different point of view. I think that's a huge thing, and something to be really celebrated and really recognised for what it is. So what do you think throughout the whole experience, especially throughout the pandemic, has been the hardest thing for you?
Probably just not being able to do the social activities, the niceties of life, of going for a coffee with a friend, going for a meal with a friend. It's the friends, it's the support network in person, you know, the hug that you need. You know, we get out of hospital, and travel as well. A huge, huge, huge therapy for me has always been travel. As soon as Jaxon was born, the first things I was doing was booking travel. It was like an escapism, you know, where we could go, and we didn't have the hospital wards. You know, I still have his needs to meet, but in a different environment, it just kind of refreshes you. And I was always really keen for him to travel to see as much as he could, because he's got life-threatening conditions. And I've kind of eased off them a little bit now, but for that first year or two, doctors were just telling me, make memories, make memories, make memories. You know, he's involved with a hospice, you know, he has stays there, we had bereavement nurses, the lot. So travel was really key for me to make really special memories for him in case something should happen. And so although I've kind of calmed down about those because he's doing so well, it's always still a very real fear. So I miss that part with him. And then the socializing and the friend side of things is just that relief, that respite of getting out of hospital and being able to book something nice, just things that would just get you through to balance out the hardships. So yeah, I would say those, but I'm eager for them to reopen.
Oh, wouldn't
do you think it's gonna happen?
I'm hoping so. I'm really, really hoping so. I can see that it might. part of me sat there going, do you know what, Harriet, you've always been a skeptic and always been like really pessimistic, and you're pegging all your hopes on this vaccine and you're just gonna be disappointed. And I don't know,
bit of a disappointment.
It's a disappointment, because I expected us to go back into lockdown after Christmas. I got that in my head and told myself that's what's going to happen, so it didn't shock me as much this time.
So basically you manifested as being in lockdown right now.
Don't put it on me. I refuse to take that one. Have it back. I'm such a pessimist naturally, and I've kind of told myself don't be surprised if this doesn't go right, but I'm hoping this time that like you say, it's the going for coffee with people, it's the physical contact, because I'm a really tactile person. I am a hugger, I miss that. I really, really miss that. And I found it really hard having the kids at home 24/7. The first lockdown, not so much, but just having them at home 24/7 and then having to explain to them why they can't necessarily go and hug other people. And I found that hard. So I'm hopeful. I'm not convinced, but I'm hopeful. And that's kind of where I'm sitting at the minute. And that's the best that I can offer, really. I think that's the best that anybody can offer. I don't know how.
Yeah, just hope. Just hope.
Just keep hoping. That's what we've got to keep doing. How does the vaccine work for you guys? Will Jaxon be given that, and is he put as a priority or not?
So Jaxon was one of the mistakes that got... So he wasn't a mistake, sorry. He got one of the letters that was a mistake that said he could go for a vaccine. And I got really excited, and then it turns out they're not appropriate for children. So that was fine. I get one as a carer, but every single day I go to log in and try and book one, there's no slots available, so I'm just waiting. So we should get one, but yeah, I think that's another aspect as well. A lot of my friends and family are key workers, so I've not been able to bubble up with anybody. The only people we see is his carer at night and his dad when he sees him. So yeah, at some points during lockdown I have like bubbled up with a friend, but then she's gone back to caring, so you know, that's had to get scrapped. So yeah, there's just nobody. So it's like,
it's
just need a hug.
I just want a cuddle. It's that extra element, like you say, it's you just want a hug, you just want to see somebody else. If I was in the position where I was a single mum, I could bubble with somebody and it wouldn't necessarily carry that extra risk, but for you it does.
Technically, with the bubbles, with his age, with his disability, with me being a single parent, we're entitled to bubble up with somebody, and you know, that could potentially just make everything feel so much better. But no.
But as much as they've given you that extra option, they've not factored the fact that actually it's great to say, well, these people can bubble up, but
it's more of a risk that it's not worth it, essentially.
Yeah, exactly.
So thank God for some social media providing us all a little bit of company. They just need to work out how we can virtually hug one another.
That's the bit that we need, some kind of internet hug. I think social media gets a really bad rep, you know, and I think it's been wonderful throughout the whole of this. I realise that it has so many problems, and I know it comes with its own trolls and its own, the anonymity that breeds contempt throughout us all. Like, I get that. I know that that's there, and I know that it's allowed people to remain anonymous and showed the worst of us. I think it's also showed the best.
Yeah.
Especially in these times when we can actually come together via it, because we can't come together any other way. And I think that's been massive. So on that note, what would be your tips that you would give to somebody who is in the same situation as you? At this moment in time, who is thinking, you know what? I'm listening to this and I relate to her so much. I could do with a hug too. What would you say to somebody?
Tips, get a teddy bear.
Go for a teddy, a puppy.
Honestly, you know when you just think, like, how did I get through this, and you've got no answers, because you're just like, I've just kept swimming. I think obviously trying your best to keep in touch with friends is huge, because it can be very easy when you're shut off from the world to just completely shut off. And I think checking in on friends and just sending those messages can keep your dynamics going. You know, phone calls, sometimes phone calls have just got me through. To have a laugh, the same kind of laugh that you would have if you're a dinner table, where, you know, I've had drives back from London from hospital and I've called a friend. I've been on the phone for 3 hours just having a laugh, and it's just been so nice. And then what else? Yeah, everyone goes on about a walk. I say, if you don't want to go for a walk, don't go for a walk.
My husband, he says exactly the same. He's like, I don't want to go for a walk. I'm like, but the fresh air is good for you. And he's like, it's not. I don't want to go for a walk.
I do believe the fresh air is good for you. So in that way, I do encourage you. But also, I felt a bit pressured to go on a daily walk. And I don't want to go on a daily walk. I'm tired. Like, I just want to sit on the sofa and have a nap. Like, I don't want to bake cakes that my child doesn't even eat. What am I baking cakes for? Like, no, I'm not making banana bread. Like, sometimes it is just, and also sometimes for that same reason, as great as social media can be, it can be quite a pressure environment. I think when you feel that kind of sometimes coming on, it is really good to just have a day of no screens and just remember the four walls around you. And some days I've turned it off and I've just cleaned the house top to bottom. And that sounds really boring, but it's been so therapeutic. And I guess it is just doing what works for you. Everyone's just trying to get through, make it to the end. And so, yeah, not exactly a top 10 tip. But
it's true though, isn't it? Because we like to create this kind of template for how we think that things should be done. And we look at other people and we're like, oh no, that looks better than mine. And in reality, we've all just got to muddle through it. And that's the same for everything in life, I think. There isn't actually ever a proper template of how things should look. And as soon as you think you've got one down, there'll be a curveball that'll get lobbed at you.
I mean, the key thing is to just go easy on yourself. Do what works for you and literally do for you, not do because you're comparing, do because other people have said that you should. Do what works for you. What will get you through the day and what will get you through the next few days and what will get you to the end of the pandemic, because that's all we can do.
Very, very true. Bang on for anybody, I think, in any situation.
I haven't made a single loaf of banana bread. Never. Not in the first one.
We made one loaf of banana bread because I make a chocolate and banana bread because I know banana bread's meant to be all healthy and stuff. So I just thought, oh, chocolate. And my kids love me for it. And it was like it was cursed in the pandemic. We tried to make it once and it just turned to like raw butter. And I just looked at the kids and I was like, brownies? Should we do brownies? I can't be doing with it. Mummy doesn't eat banana bread. You're not going to eat this crap. So let's move on. That was the other one that I kept seeing floating around, soda bread. And I just thought, no, I didn't even consider attempting it. I feel like you're the only one that's not done it. You feel like the only one that's not watched.
These are the kind of things that made the news during the pandemic.
Isn't that worrying though, that this is what made the news? This is what made it.
Banana bread.
Banana bread made the news. Top 10 recipes. Mine with chocolate in it wasn't included. Obviously.
Oh, that would definitely be number one.
Only if it works.
Yeah, the failed one, not so sure about.
Failed one, absolutely not. Thank you so much for taking the time to talk to me and for just being you and being so honest and creating that support for yourself. Because in doing that, I think you have created something really wonderful that will help so many people. So thank you.
Thank you for having me.